Michelle Dixie here. Today I want to talk to you about some of the things that I wish I had known before I walked the Camino Francis this summer. Although I walked the Camino Francis, most of these tips will apply to any Camino somebody would do in Spain. The first thing I wish I had known, and that I learned definitely the hard way, is that receiving packages from outside of the country can be an absolute pain. I needed certain brand specific items that I could not find on Spain's Amazon page, because if I could have found them, just so y'all know this option is available, you can have things sent to Amazon lockers, which are in some of the bigger cities that you'll pass through on the Camino. But because I couldn't find the specific thing, I needed something sent from home. And I thought, oh, it won't be a big deal because they'll probably hold it general delivery, just like places did when I was on the Appalachian Trail, Pacific Crest Trail, Continental Divide Trail. But the difference is that I'm sending from the US into Spain. And I had asked the Correos, which is the postal service in Spain, if they could hold a package for me if it was sent from my home. What I assumed that they knew, and they obviously didn't, is that my home was not in Spain and it would be something coming from the US. So I actually sent two packages, and when I got to the Correos to pick up my packages, one package was there, and in place of one of the other packages was a letter that was written in all Spanish that I couldn't understand. And the woman who worked there spoke only Spanish, so she couldn't help translate and let me know what the form needed from me for me to receive my package. But customs held my package, and I ended up, after a while, finding somebody who could help me with the form. I filled it out, sent it back to them, and then I ended up having to pay import taxes and then having it sent from the original Correos it was going to go to the one that I was near once customs cleared everything. So I ended up not getting my package until I was almost finished with the Camino, and it was a very expensive package to receive after all of the shipping from one place to another and then paying the taxes on the item. So I would highly suggest that you avoid this if at all possible, because it can just really be a pain and be really expensive. So just a heads up, I would try to find something on Spain's Amazon page rather than having something sent from outside of the country into you on the Camino if you need something. The second thing I wish I had known or considered is that having a down sleeping bag and jacket probably wasn't a good idea for going somewhere that I had a good chance of coming into contact with bed bugs. Now, I know a lot of folks will tell you that you do not need a sleeping bag on the Camino because you'll be staying in albergues, so a silk liner will do, and that usually repels bed bugs or deters them from biting you or getting on you. However, if I did not have a sleeping bag, I would have been cold a lot of nights. And I've had other folks tell me that even in the middle of the summertime, they had some nights where they were pretty chilly because all they had was a liner. Now, a lot of the albergues, not all of them, but a lot of them will have blankets that you could use if you're cold, but keep in mind that those don't usually get washed. And if they do, then not often. So I decided I already have a down sleeping bag that's very packable and lightweight, and I also have a coat to keep warm with, so why get something else? I don't have any synthetic sleeping bags. But if I had to do it over again, I'd probably just get a warm rated synthetic sleeping bag that was as light as possible, because when you come into contact with bed bugs and you need to wash your stuff to get rid of them, the best way to treat them is with heat. They cannot withstand the heat. So if you wash them at a hot temperature and dry them at a hot temperature, then you're good. The problem was, me and Montana took our down sleeping bags and jackets to a laundromat, because that's how you have to wash down sleeping bags, is in a front loading washer and dryer. But a lot of the washer machines, and especially the ones at a laundromat, all of them in fact, that I saw had automatic dispensing soap, which is really convenient when you don't want to go buy a whole big old thing of laundry detergent. But when you've got down, you have to use a special detergent, or if I had just wanted to run it through a water cycle without any soap, I had no option for that. There was no way to say, no, we don't want soap. We knew that the washer machine wasn't gonna have that option. So we just rinsed everything the best we could at the hotel that we were staying at with hot water, and then tried to wring it out. We went to the laundromat and I thought, this is gonna take forever to dry because it didn't go through spin cycle. But we lucked out because the owner was there who allowed us to put our down stuff in the washer machine just on spin cycle and then in the dryer. So everything worked out in the long run. You can probably treat your stuff with permethrin before you go to help deter bed bugs. I've heard folks say that you can buy it while you're over there, but I didn't find any permethrin in the Pilgrim slash gear shops that I saw, nor did I find any at the pharmacies. I had folks tell me, yeah, you can just get bed bug treatment at the pharmacies. The only thing they had was bug spray and anti-itch cream for Montana's bug bites. So I would treat things before you go if you want to help prevent bed bugs, and then definitely have stuff that you don't mind just throwing in the washer and dryer at hot temperatures with regular detergent. Another thing that I kind of learned the hard way is that siesta in Spain is real. Most of the businesses, including restaurants, will close roughly somewhere between 2 and 5 p.m. So they'll be open before and then open later. But in that time frame, if you need anything from pharmacies, restaurants, some of the restaurants might have snacks and things, but you're not going to get a real meal. And just any business that you think would be open in that time frame will probably be closed. Also, keep in mind that I just said 2 p.m. to 5 p.m., but that's not really a thing there. They go by what a lot of the folks here in the U.S. would know as military time. So it would be like the 14th hour through the 17th hour businesses will be closed. Next, I wish I had known that a lot of the Pilgrim's menus throughout the Camino were going to be nearly exactly the same. At the beginning, it was exciting because there might be a little variation here or there, but a lot of the villages have the same menus that they offer to pilgrims from the beginning to the end. The pilgrims' menus are nice though, because you've got a starter, a main course, dessert, and usually water and or wine that comes with it. So those meals often have the same items, even though you can pick, you know, there are only so many variations that you can do. And even the regular bar menu, so not the pilgrims' meal specifically, but all of the bars from place to place have pretty similar food options on them. The only place that I really found any variety was in the bigger cities. I mean, you just always hear about Spain and the food and the tapas, and it's all good. It's just that the Camino Francis specifically, and I'm sure a lot of the other Caminos, aren't in big cities all the time. A lot of times you're in these smaller villages, and it just seems convenient for them to serve the same kind of meals. And I never thought that I would get sick of French fries, but it is something that we had over and over and over. So a lot of the stuff starts to get a bit old. So I would say that if you're in a place where you do find something that's different than you've seen before, go ahead and take that opportunity to enjoy something different. Also, if you have the option of staying at an albergue where they have a kitchen and you can kind of group some people together and cook a meal together, I think that would be really neat to take that opportunity to do so. And don't get me wrong, there are a few places along the way that do something completely different as a group dinner, and those places, to me, were truly treasured, because honestly, that's the thing that I would say I miss the most about home while I was there is the food. And I know that sounds crazy, because when you go to a different country, it's exciting to try what foods they have, but you'll see what I mean when you get out there. Also, I wish that I had known more Spanish before I went. This isn't a necessity, and even if your Spanish level is zero, you'll be fine. There are enough people who speak English, even if it's broken English, that you'll probably be able to get by. And you're gonna learn while you're out there. You're gonna hear something enough that you'll start picking up on it. But I took Spanish 1 and Spanish 2 in high school, and I lived in South Florida a lot of years, where there is a larger Spanish-speaking community, although that type of Spanish is different than Spain Spanish. But I was familiar with numbers and some of the basic phrases, like asking where the bathroom is and saying that I need to pay, etc. I would suggest, if you can, before you go, to check out Duolingo. It's a free app, and it'll teach you a lot of the basic phrases for, you know, being in a restaurant and dealing with stuff that you would need to say there, or while traveling. And I think that even though you may not speak fluent Spanish, if you go somewhere and you show that you're trying, I found that people really respect that, and they're more willing to help you than if you just stand there and expect other people to speak a language that isn't their first language just because you're too lazy to learn. The Google Translate app was pretty helpful to us, especially when reading menus, because you can just use your camera on your phone, hover over the menu, and it'll translate. Now, it doesn't always come out clearly, and you might find that you embarrass yourself because you use words incorrectly. One example was I asked for a straw because when I'm drinking coffee or wine with having braces, I'm supposed to drink out of a straw. And Google Translate told me the word was paja, P-A-J-A. And I think that the way that we talk about barn straw, it's a straw, right? That's the word paja, but also it's a sexual thing. I'll let y'all figure that one out. But so I was asking this bartender for basically something sexual when all I was trying to ask for was a straw. So, I mean, it can be kind of funny, I guess, or I mean, I don't know, maybe that could have gotten me into some kind of trouble, but she eventually corrected me and said, no, you want pajita. And so I was thankful for that. Again, most people are patient and helpful, but you just got to put yourself out there. That's how you learn, is getting outside of your comfort zone. And to start with, I would get the sweats when I would have to speak to somebody who only spoke Spanish and with my broken and mispronounced words. But towards the end, I didn't even get the sweats anymore. I was relaxed. And even though I couldn't always express exactly what I wanted to, usually I could get the point across. Another thing that Montana and I wish that we had been more aware of or had just had more information on was the tradition of carrying a stone to the Cruz de Ferro, which is the Iron Cross, right outside of Fontsabadon. So a lot of times the pilgrims will carry a stone or some other trinket from their home or early on in their journey and then leave it at the Iron Cross. And there's this huge mound of all of these little trinkets and stones that some are probably in memory of loved ones, etc. And some folks leave things there to kind of symbolize unloading a burden and leaving it there on the Camino. Some people like to go there and leave something and pray for somebody. It's really unique to the individual, I would say. We weren't really aware of this early on, so we didn't have our stones for very long. But just a heads up, if you'd like to put a little bit more thought into that, and participate in that tradition. Next, I was surprised how much history there was along the Camino. I mean, not exactly, because I do understand that it's an ancient pilgrimage, but I guess I was really surprised at how little of it seemed to be documented. When you go somewhere in the US, there are often placards and signs telling all of the history and information, but along the Camino, I would walk past something that would clearly be a ruins and there might not be anything there to inform me of what it was. Now, I know a lot of folks carry the Camino guidebook that probably has some historical information. I did end up later on in the journey downloading an ebook that gave me some information, but I really wish that there was some app that went right along the Camino and as you went day by day, you would really know what you were going to see historically. And I know that there is a ton of history, so that might be a pretty tough project. But if y'all know of any apps like that that exist that will kind of give you step-by-step history along the Camino and some of the things that you're seeing, I just think that that would be really cool. Now, this next one I've already figured out for myself the hard way, but I actually polled some of my fellow pilgrims and asked them some of the things that they wish they had known, and one of the things was that they didn't need boots. Now, I know a lot of folks get touchy about footwear. Some people say that their ankles need that support from boots, and that's fine. If you know that you need that, then go with it. You know what's best for you. However, if you just think because you're going to be walking every day that you must have hiking boots to be successful at that, it's not necessarily true. Most of the folks out there that I saw that had boots said that they wish that they had just gone with some sort of trail runners or tennis shoe, because a lot of the time you're on hardened surfaces like a road or gravel or some kind of improved walkway. It's not really a wilderness path, and I mean, even on those I wear trail runners. So that's something to think about. If you haven't done a ton of hiking or backpacking and you think, hey, if I'm gonna do this and be outside, I'm gonna have to have hiking boots, you might not really need that and it might be overkill for you. Another thing that I've learned on previous adventures, and I took my own advice and did that on this path, but I heard this a lot from folks out there and pilgrims that I've kept in touch with since finishing, is they wish that they had taken more time out there. It seems that people bust out the gate, racing each other, thinking that they have to keep up with certain people because they don't want to be alone, when really you're going to meet more wonderful people behind the people that passed you. Or maybe they think that it's shameful if they don't finish in the 30 to 35 day window that most do. Montana and I took about, I think, a month and a half to finish, we just took our time. We had over 2 months to be out there in Europe. We wanted to enjoy it and avoid injuries. So that's something that I have learned in the hard way in the past, but that some of my fellow pilgrims agree that they wish they had known, is just slow down, take your time if you have it, and really soak it all in. And finally, I wish that I'd had a little bit better understanding of Buen Camino, and that's how pilgrims often greet each other out there. It just means good way or good journey to you. And I knew that people said that to each other out there, but I thought, oh, is this gonna be kind of cringy or cheesy? And it was a little awkward the first couple of times I said it. But honestly, it was actually really cool, because I'd go up to somebody and I might not know if they're from Germany, France, Belgium, Spain, wherever. But I knew that if they were also a pilgrim, that I could say Buen Camino and it was showing a little bit of kindness, you know, smile and say Buen Camino. And a lot of the locals out there also greet the pilgrims like that. So you might not be able to communicate anything else to each other, but you can just say hello by saying Buen Camino. And I think that that's something that's special that you continue to carry on with you. And that's something that was very different for this pilgrimage versus the long distance hikes that I've done in the US, because there isn't one specific thing that people say to each other, but on the Caminos, that is something specific to it and special to it. And I know from now on, if I ever run into somebody that's done the Camino or is familiar with it, I can say that to them, and it means something different having done it than just knowing about it. So, but don't believe me, get out there and try it yourself and you'll see what I mean. All right, y'all, well, that is all I have for you today. If you are a pilgrim and you have done any of the Caminos before, I would love for y'all to share some of the things that you wish you had known before going out to the Camino in the comments below. That way folks who are planning to do a Camino in the future will have some pointers before they get out there. And that way maybe they won't be as surprised by some of these things and they can plan a little bit better. If y'all enjoyed this video or found it useful, don't forget to subscribe before you go. Thank y'all so much for watching, and we will see y'all next time.
Yay!